Good evening, friends. Welcome to this session on self-awareness. Today, I will be, accompanied by Subashini Suri. She is an OD consultant and she's also a leadership coach. Has 10 years of experience working in this area of organization development. So I welcome Subashini. And welcome, Subashini.
Hi, Venkat. Hello, Venkat. So happy to join you in this conversation with Raja sir. Thank you so much for this opportunity, and I really look forward to this conversation.
Great. Absolutely a pleasure having you here. And our guest for today is Mr. Raja Krishnamoorthy. It is a well-reputed and well-known by everyone in the field of leadership, development, organization development, an accomplished actor, scriptwriter, cartoonist, and director. We all know him as Bheem Rao, the father of Anil Kapoor and Nayak. He's been supporting many entrepreneurs and startups as a OD expert and leadership expert. He advises CEOs and founders. Today, he is with us and we are so obliged and honored to have him in this session where he would actually, talk about and make us a point about the self-awareness. Welcome, sir. And so good to have you here. And like always, it's a pleasure speaking to you. There's a lot of learning that we gain, while we speak to you. So Subashini, I'll request you to take this forward from here.
Yes. Thank you, Venkat. I'm super thrilled and really excited about this session, especially because the topic is so interesting, self-awareness. And I'll shoot my first question right away to Raja sir. Hello, sir. Good evening.
Good evening, Subashini. Such a joy to connect and talk to the two of you, and through that to all of the friends over there. And I think, Venkat, I must confess that I'm starting to enjoy this so much that this may be becoming a habit, and you may have to carry the burden of doing this session probably once in a month. Look forward to this. Go ahead,
Subashini. It's an honor and a pleasure, sir. I will actually now do that every month. I'll actually take that as a commitment now.
You know, there is this concept in our philosophy. It's also there in Buddhism. Buddham Sharanam Gacchami, Sangam Sharanam Gacchami. So Sat Sangha. Sangam is coming together. Sat Sangha is coming together with goodness. So the whole concept of Sat Sangha happens in the Eastern philosophy. It happens in the Vedantic philosophy, in the Buddhist philosophy. And I think this is a beautiful Sat Sangha. In fact, it's strange that I address one of the forums it's an international group of Masons. I'm forgetting the first part. I just did a month and a half back, and that particular group was called as Satsang. So I think this is a Satsang that we are on to. All the best. Go ahead.
Awesome. So I'll start with my first question. So earlier this week, when we were just beginning to plan the session, I was chatting with Venkat about this, about self-awareness, and very casually I asked him, do you think you are self-aware, and what's your response to that? And Venkat immediately came back with a response with his strengths, with his areas of development. When he approaches a certain work situation, he shared with me about his mindset. How does he go into something? And quickly he did a bit of an analysis about himself and shared it with me. So that's when it struck me, is knowing about your own strengths and your areas of improvement self-awareness, because you're sort of aware about your own capabilities. Is that what it is? Is that close to being fully self-aware in your opinion?
Yeah, I think that's a terrific question for this conversation to begin with. This is an interesting question that you'll find coming up in many forums, especially in interview forums. where, you know, the interviewer would typically ask a candidate as to tell me more about yourself. And then, you know, there'll be either a hint or a very clear asking of a question saying that. So tell me more about your, you know, key strengths and weaknesses. So if you look at it carefully, terminology plays a very important role in our perspective building. Okay. So the self-assessment, which is assessing what are the things that work for me, which I call as my strengths, assessing what are the things that seem to challenge me, which oftentimes we call as the areas of improvement. Sometimes when we are a little more honest or a little more reflective, saying areas of weakness or, you know, whatever. So this self-assessment is an exercise that most of us do, and we are wanting to do that. And there is a reason behind that, because throughout life, all right, we have been taught from our childhood, from the earliest of stage, to make an assessment of ourselves. Assessment of capability. So the ability to do something in this whole world of what I call as the doing, therefore capability is an important part, competence is an important part. Not being able to do, not being able to achieve is associated with lack of capabilities or as challenges about you. And therefore to be aware of those limitations and therefore be able to overcome that becomes an important part. So therefore this whole world of self-assessment, you know, kind of opens up. Now the interesting thing is even there, you could, you know, begin with, you know, probably complete blindness to your own self. And then partial recognition and, you know, kind of knowing of your strengths, weaknesses to, let's say, significant, you know, kind of knowing of your strengths and weaknesses. And then using a whole lot of tools. And, you know, the tools are dime a dozen available for the assessment purposes. I mean, you know, there are so many branded names. I don't want to, you know, kind of particularly talk about that. Whether it is about propensities, whether it is about characteristics, whether it is about capabilities, whether it's about sheer competencies, you got assessment tools. Therefore, you do a self-assessment test and you get some result. That's one part of it. Then in terms of feedback sessions, typically like in organizations, there are, you know, feedback sessions, performance assessment feedback session, you know, that annual ritual slash tamasha slash compulsory event that happens in most organizations. So, you know, all right, I know that you're expecting a growth in promotion, but I have to tell you that you're not still ready. I need to give you a feedback about your, you know. So the whole idea of giving a feedback to a person, which therefore helps him to understand himself. So I want you to understand yourself much better is a good intention. Mm-hmm. But what gets shared typically by and large is about, again, an assessment of capabilities. I'm saying that's a good beginning, but that's not self-awareness by itself completely. It's a nice part of the beginning of self-awareness. Self-assessment as a process is a nice part of this journey of self-awareness. Okay? So I think that's a good thing, because at least then what do I do about that? You know, therefore, what are the actions that I take towards that? Are there some processes which will help me to move towards closer to that? I think all those things will get facilitated, helped by this first step or the first few steps, which is self-assessment before, you know, kind of self-awareness. I'm not even saying self-assessment in the pathway of self-awareness. That's okay. Then comes, I think, an interesting point. When I think the clarity, if it falls into place, saying that it's not just about how I am doing or what I am doing and how well I am doing. It's about how am I as a being. Then I think then a shift takes place. I think that is the interesting, beautiful combination. Sure, all of us are part of roles in life. No question at all. We are chosen to be in social systems from the family level to society level to organizational level. Inevitable that if you are into a social structure, you got to be in roles. So, you know, somebody is a wife, somebody is a husband, somebody is a dad, or a combination of all of that. Somebody is a student. And obviously, the moment you are into roles, one of those 8 criteria of roles, which is expectations fulfillment, comes in. Obviously, the moment expectation fulfillment comes in, capability to deliver that comes in. And therefore, that capability of your, you know, of playing that role becomes an important part. So you're very efficient in managing that role, okay, in terms of delivering expectation, is hinging on this fact, how well can you make a self-assessment? I'm saying excellent. But role and expectation fulfillment about performance is again the world of doing. Good. So do that very well. That makes you, you know, a confident, you know, a good role holder. But then to discover the larger you that you are, you're also getting into discovering the being that you are. And I think self-awareness is therefore that larger discovery of the being that you are, into which your role or your many roles are parts of that. But the whole is much, much, much larger than those parts. So self-awareness is a much larger canvas. I think self-assessment could be probably a territory in that. And therefore, we are talking about the journey and the exploration of the whole space when we talk about self-awareness. So I think as I'm talking about it, I'm smiling because I'm recognizing again the power and the limitation of language, you know. So, you know, I'm able to talk about what I call as a world of metaphor, and to be able to talk about that. And that's the beauty. When it comes to the larger meaning making of life, necessarily metaphor, which could even sometimes sound philosophic or poetic, has got to come into play. That's because life itself is so large, okay? And therefore, for us to find that, you know, kind of that smaller space of our role, all right? Self-assessment definitely helps tremendously. But to get exposed and enjoy this the humongousness of life, I think self-awareness makes a difference.
Wonderful, sir. Thank you. Thank you for that. I think what my mind is thinking right now is, by the end of this session, I hope we get a small slice of understanding the entire gamut of self-awareness. We have made a beginning now. So I think by the end of the session, some more questions will get answered. So Venkat, over to you.
Exploration has started. Now let's see. Yeah, okay.
Actually, this forces me to ask another question related to this. We talk about self-reflection also, right? Now, this self-assessment is self-reflection, self-awareness. Does self-reflection also, you know, a part of self-awareness?
Okay. Good question again. And it's a very meaningful question. All right, so look at this. In a way, assessment is a process, a way of doing things. Reflection is a process, way of doing it. So for assessment, which is typically an evaluative process, there is an interesting way of managing that process. So let's call it as the process that helps another process, or let's say, an element or a sub-process which helps one important process. Let's say, suppose you are saying that, yeah, I'm cooking today. Then what you're actually saying is, I'm going to wash vegetables, I'm going to cut vegetables, I'm going to, you know, kind of create a mise en place, and I'm going to grind my, you know, coconut, I'm going to keep the, you know, kind of curry paste ready. There are a whole lot of things. Cooking is that larger thing. So suppose you therefore take self-assessment, okay, as a process. Like we talked about, you could have some very system-oriented kind of self-assessment. You may have tools, and those tools could be digital tools or, you know, kind of whatever kind of tools. You may apply those tools and do some evaluation on them. Reflection is, again, a beautiful process that helps you to either do self-assessment, and it is also, by the way, an important part of awareness building. So what is reflection all about? Then we come to that particular question. Reflection is the ability to look at yourself, okay? So when you look into a mirror, you know, there's a reflection. You look into clean water and show your face, there's a reflection. So I think normally the word reflection is associated with this phenomena of being able to see as it is. So what is this being able to see as it is? See, all of us are people with a sense of self-worth, with a sense of self-pride, with a sense of value. I'm probably in whatever form, certain feel good, which could be, you know, kind of our positive ego, as some people describe it, all of that. And that is a very good friend. And that is also a very good protector. You know what he does? That sense of pride, sense of self-worth, he protects you from seeing your reality a lot of times. So as the thought comes, it says, no, you're terrific, don't worry. You know, no, that's not your problem, it's somebody else's problem. So sometimes you've got to ask this friend, hey, stay away, man. Thank you so much, okay? My sense of self-worth, my sense of confidence, all that is good. Right now, I don't require you. Right now, what I require is a mirror, not a cover-up, not an armor. Because unless I take this armor, I can't see myself. But thank you so much. When I go to a battle, I'll take you, but stay on the side and look into the mirror and say, hey, can I really see myself? So reflection is a very beautiful process where we become naked to ourselves. And in that nakedness, taking away all our armor and defense mechanism, we are able to have a very authentic, very integrity-based kind of look at ourselves, our transactions, our experiences, and are willing to identify ourselves as the source of the causative factors of anything that happens. What is it that I brought to the situation? What is it that I caused? What is it that I could have done about anything? Taking that accountability, ownership, and then very, very honestly reflecting about it, taking away the judgment from me, about me, taking away the judgment about the other, whatever, purifying that whole process and examining that. Whether it's a process, whether it's a person, yourself, whatever, all right? That no holds barred, looking, reflecting, looking at the mirror, looking at the pure water, that would be reflection. And I think that's a terrific thing. I think one of the wonderful qualities for good assessment and good awareness is a reflection. So in the Eastern philosophy, when they talk about self-awareness building, they talk about three very important parts, okay? Shravanam, mananam, nididhyasanam, okay? These are beautiful terminologies. So part of nididhyasanam is the willingness to sit down and pay attention to yourself without any kind of frills. So one part of that you could use, that we can talk is the quality of reflection that we're talking. Yeah, so self-reflection is a beautiful and very essential part of building, an unbiased assessment, as well as in this larger canvas of becoming aware. Reflection is a very beautiful process. It is the purity of being able to look at yourself, period.
Yeah. Beautiful. Okay. I would like to, with your permission, I would like to actually play a 3-minute clip from a movie. Mm-hmm. Okay. This reminds me of a specific conversation which we had. Mm-hmm. And it also comes after listening to your the previous question, the answer to the previous question, the way you explained self-assessment and how important is self-reflection. So I would like to play that clip and then probably, ask the question that I have in mind.
Yeah, sure.
Just one.
I was in pain, caring for them, listening to them, applying a cold cloth until a fever breaks. If this is practicing medicine, if this is treating a patient, then I am guilty as charged, sir.
Did you consider the ramifications of your actions? What if one of your patients had died?
What's wrong with death, sir? What are we so mortally afraid of? Why can't we treat death with a certain amount of humanity and dignity and decency and, God forbid, maybe even humor? Death is not the enemy, gentlemen. If we're going to fight a disease, let's fight one of the most terrible diseases of all, indifference. Now, I've sat in your schools and heard people lecture on transference and professional distance. Transference is inevitable, sir. Every human being has an impact on another. Why don't we want that in a patient-doctor relationship? That's why I've listened to your teachings and I believe they're wrong. A doctor's mission should be not just to prevent death, but also to improve the quality of life. That's why you treat a disease, you win, you lose. You treat a person, I guarantee you'll win, no matter what the outcome. Now here today, this room is full of medical students. Don't let them anesthetize you. Don't let them numb you out to the miracle of life. Always live in awe of the glorious mechanism of the human body. Let that be the focus of your studies and not a quest for grades, which will give you no idea what kind of doctor you will become.
Mr. Adams, please turn and
don't wait till you're on the ward to get your humanity back. Start your interviewing skills now. Start talking to strangers. Talk to your friends. Talk to wrong numbers. Talk to everyone.
Mr. Adams.
And cultivate friendships with those amazing people standing in the back of the room. Nurses, they can teach you. They've been with people every day. They wade through blood and shit. They have a wealth of knowledge to share with you. And so do the professors you respect, the ones who are not dead from the heart up. Share their compassion. Let that be contagious.
Mr. Adams, I demand that you turn and address the board.
Sir, I want to be a doctor with all my heart. I wanted to become a doctor so I could serve others. And because of that, I've lost everything. But I've also gained everything. I've shared the lives of patients and staff members at the hospital. I've laughed with them. I've cried with them. This is what I want to do with my life. And as God is my witness, no matter what your decision today, sir, I will still become the best damn doctor the world has ever seen. Now, you have the ability to prevent me from graduating. You can keep me from getting the title and the white coat. But you can't control my spirit, gentlemen. You can't keep me from learning. You can't keep me from studying. So you have a choice. You can have me as a professional colleague, passionate, or you can have me as an outspoken outsider, still adamant. Either way, I'll probably still be viewed as a thorn. But I promise you one thing. I am a thorn that will not go away.
Is that all?
I hope not, sir.
We will adjourn briefly.
The clipping I wanted to show from the movie Pat Adams, where actor Robin Williams is well known for his amazing acting skills in many movies. But this specific clipping, I like it so very much because it actually displays a lot of qualities with respect to societal awareness and serving and humanity-based serving mentality. And the way he actually explains and briefs what he wants to be, I want to be a doctor, whether you graduate me, whether you accept me or not, but this is what I'm going to continue doing. Now, I remember in one of our conversations, normally when we introduce ourselves in a professional gathering or in a meeting, we tend to introduce ourselves as this is so-and-so, as so-and-so from so-and-so university. Now, in my case, I'm probably introduced, I'm Venkat and I'm an OD consultant and I want to be a leadership coach and I'm from IBS, Hyderabad, in my organization development and human resource management. But I remember in one of our conversations, you specifically mentioned, we need to detach ourselves from the social status and the formal designations and move beyond the objective reality so that we tend to be opening up and build and learn from there. Could I request you to elaborate on that point, giving your previous answers on self-reflection? I think so.
In the first place, Venkat, I'm amazed that you brought this clipping for this session, for this. You know, it melts the heart. It can actually make the eyes moist. It's that beautiful sequence that you brought in. And what I'm amazed is about its complete relevance to what we spoke just a few minutes back when Subashini began with that question about assessment. So here is a panel of people who are sitting on the bench of assessment and are saying that, do your qualifications and competencies fit into the normal, formal assessment of being a doctor? Are you a doctor? Such a terrific thing. So they have clarity in their mind about something called a role, and doctor is a role. Hey, here you are seeming to be either doing or claiming to be providing the services provided by a role called doctor. But that seems to be a non-acceptable thing, because if it's a role and competencies, then there are institutions and authorities who are authorized to legitimize, certify that you have that. Do you have that? So the whole drama is this question of structures and systems of society which validate competency capabilities of roles. And from that, you know, kind of a platform and premise, a set of people are asking someone who probably is a non-role, and he says beautifully, I'm human. It's humanity that I'm talking about. It is capability that you're talking about. What are we talking about? I don't think you could have chosen a more beautiful, you know, kind of clipping than this to just talk about the same thing that we, you know, kind of. So they're talking about an assessment process. Have you gone through that? Do you have that? And he's saying, what are you talking about? Where is the question of assessment? Therefore he talks about, you know, to me, it's about creating a quality of life. It's about treating someone. And the moment you're using the word treating someone, what he's talking about is treating someone as a human being to another human being. And you know what is treating a human being as another human being, all that it means? You know, we use the word empathy or, you know, whatever that. It is sheer engagement with the other human being, period. And the word engagement is beautiful by itself. Engagement is to create a connect. That's it. You engage a gear. You connect something so that it shifts into a particular kind of speed mode. You engage to a girl or to a boy, which means the distance between two people is broken and the formal acceptance that they are together. Engagement is togetherness. The counterpoint, the opposite of that in roles is evaluation. Let's get this funda in place. It's engagement versus evaluation. But so funny in this world today, as much as before marriage engagement takes place, before engagement, a lot of evaluation takes place. Okay. A whole lot of evaluation. Okay. How tall you are, how strong you are, how studied you are, how educated you are, how rich you are, you know, how, you know, kind of modern you are, a whole lot of, you know, evaluations. And then after all those evaluations are crossed, probably then the possibility of engagement. So you take away all these, you know, kind of norms and standards of a role, what you're left with is the beautiful thing that, you know, Robin Williams talks about. You strip and then you're just a human, which is the other thing that you are talking about. What happens to us, and in our, you know, kind of again, the Eastern philosophy, in a manner of speaking, the word ego is addressed by a word called ahamkar. Again, that has got two parts. Aham is I or myself. Kar, sense of I. Okay. So that's such an interesting thing. Or the sense of I. So normally when you say I, what do you mean by I? About myself. So there is this self-identification. Okay, so the I stands for self-identification. Self-awareness is beyond any identification. Look at the interesting thing. The I stands for identification, and the identification is typically with roles. The first identification begins with the name. So who are you? I'm Raja Krishnamoorthy. Okay. None of us say, my name is Raja Krishnamoorthy. My name is Subashini. My name is Venkat. Because that's what you are. Because sometimes you are saying, I'm angry. Sometimes you are saying that I'm really upset. Sometimes you are saying, I'm thrilled. And then you're also saying, I'm Venkat. Which one are you really? Okay. You know, our language is so funny. All right. So are you Mr. Angry? Are you Mr. Happy? Are you Mr. Upset? Are you Mr. Thrill? Are you Mr. Venkat? Then you suddenly realize that, hey, you know what? There are things that are given to me. My parents gave me a name, which means name is something that I received, I got. I have, therefore, a name. Then you suddenly realize that, yeah, I'm an MBA. Are you an MBA? Or do you have an MBA degree? Oh, that's right. I have a degree called MBA. I'm Senior Vice President of Operations. Is it? Are you Senior Vice President of Operations? Or you have a position? Yeah, that's right. I have a position. So I have a name. I'm the third son. You're a third son, or you in the family structure were the third one who was born. And therefore, you have a linearity-wise a position. Oh, I have a position. Now, suddenly you start saying, you know what? For the so many things that I have, but you know, I'm confused now. You're confused, or you're saying that I have now a lack of clarity. Oh my God, now I realize. That means in terms of language usage, many things which I have, which I have taken, which I have come to possess, I completely mix it up with myself and make it so much an integral part of me that I start saying that I'm Venkat, I'm angry, I'm an MBA, I'm Senior Vice President, I am a husband, but the truth is, I'm a human being, but I have so many of these attachments to me. And in every one of those attachments, I've got a very clear possibility of being evaluated as to whether it is adequate or not adequate. Because did I pass my MBA exam? Then I'm an adequate MBA. Did I really cross my probation period and get confirmed in my job? Then I'm an adequate vice president. Did my wife run away from me after 6 months, or she continues to be in a relationship of marriage for 6 years, then I'm adequately an husband. So you have a whole lot of world of criteria, other than probably your name. But there are, of course, people who say, I hate my name, but I can't do anything about it. All right. But people can change names. You can go to the government gazette and you can change your name. You can't change yourself. All right. Fantastic. So it's such a simple thing. If I know that there's a difference between what I acquire in life as a result of what I have, and that who am I, that core entity which receives all of this and loses many of this, adds on many of this, kind of discounts many of this, because this will keep changing. That is the truth. I'm Venkat is the truth all the time in terms of my name, all right? But no, Venkat the baby, Venkat the small boy, Venkat the, you know, kind of adolescent, Venkat the youth, Venkat the adult, Venkat the husband, Venkat the father. All those Venkats were different, okay, in the passage of time, all right? But in terms of sheer identity as to who this creature is, we call you Venkat, or you call me Raja, or we call her Subhashini. So the difference between many things that we have, I have a name, I have a role, I have a relationship, I have a qualification, I have a position. This world of haves will keep happening all the time. And what I have, one day I will not have, for sure. It is possible. What I get, I can lose. But there's something which will never be lost, which is the recipient, me, the self. Self will have all these objective realities coming to me, because these are all objective realities. Okay. Because roles are part of the structure, my education is part of a system, all this will keep coming and they will keep changing. An MBA 20 years back is not the same MBA today, all right? Why? Even a husband 20 years back is not the same husband today in terms of definitions, all right? Because, you know, if suppose you take the Indian society, maybe 30 years back, separation was the taboo, all right? In the Western society, it was pretty okay. A lot, I mean, I'm not, you know, kind of making any quick analysis, but far easily accepted. There was no difficulty from the emperors and the kings to the commoners. Separation was an easy thing. But in India, in the Indian culture or whatever, at least about 30, 40 years back, you know, it was a commitment of a different kind, all right? And whatever reasons, right or wrong reasons. But today, well, it's different. Which means all these things which can change, which can modify, that changing realities, therefore those objective realities are bound to change. So interestingly, what we realize is there is a difference between who I am in terms of my core and all that I pick up in life. And we have been conditioned by and large to believe that what we have been given, gifted, and what we have is predominantly the most important part of what we are, who we are. And therefore, to the question of who you are, we land up answering with the question, what I have. That is the phenomena that you're talking about. And this, what I have, is called in our culture as ahamkar, because you are talking about minus, which is about what I have. And by the way, ahamkar in a simple terminology is called the ego. So the ability to detach your ego and then make yourself that clearer one without the attachments of whatever that you have, that clearing part, which helps you therefore to see the clear reflection, that is the purifying the vision process. And that purified vision, by the way, is called awareness.
My God, it's so very clear now. I think, oh my God, most of us, we get so fascinated and we actually talk with great pride, you know, I am so and so. But now it's so clear that it's not I am so and so. That is going to change eventually. What you are is what is within you. Beautiful, fantastic. Thank you. Subashini, over to you.
So, sir, I was wondering, when you mentioned self-reflection, and there's something that I experience in this attempt to become more self-aware. So as I try and become more self-aware, I see that I watch myself more. I see that I become more conscious of what I'm saying, what I'm feeling. So I sort of observe myself in a given situation, and it helps me most of the time. I feel that I'm one step closer to self-awareness than if I'm just reacting impulsively. But what I want to understand is, am I on the right path to become more self-aware? Now, this seems like a lot of work to always be conscious. It seems like something that might get easier over a period of time, but right now, it seems like a lot of work to me. It seems like being alert all the time, it's a very conscious process. It is not coming naturally to me. What would you say about that?
Mm-hmm. Okay. So there are, a couple of very important things that you're, bringing into this discussion. I'm so happy that these thoughts are getting, coming up. So this word is, I'm conscious that you talked about. Okay. And you talked about, a lot of work, and whether, one can be a lot more, in that state, not more in that zone, Yeah. That's the other question that you ask. Again, like I said, language is an amazing thing that it helps us to understand. A language also, because it's a tool, it has its limitation. For example, the term consciousness. Imagine a situation, you're gone to your best friend's a marriage or engagement or, birthday. And somebody says, hey, let's do a click. And then somebody, gives a camera. And then you pinch your friend and say, don't be so self-conscious, man. And take it easy. Doesn't that happen?
Sure, yeah.
So what is that self-consciousness? It has almost a negative kind of a terminology, right? In that context, which means you're preoccupied with yourself. And as a result, you're so kind of narcissist. You're so worried, or there seems to be something which is tensing you up, and that tension is being seen. Don't be so self-conscious. This is the challenge of language, because the term by itself is so innocent, so pure, okay? But in terms of the world of usage, we have already converted that into a bit of a tool, which gives you a negative indication. So I'm saying first let go of that, okay? Because consciousness is an awesome reality, fundamental reality. Therefore, science talks about universal consciousness, cosmic consciousness. Philosophy talks about universal consciousness, cosmic consciousness. And therefore, if science and philosophy in some way are talking about that, I think one of those rare things where the world of analytical thinking and the world of what you may call a subjective reality are coming close and saying hello to each other and joining hands. I think consciousness is a phenomenal thing. So what is that? What is that? I would say, for our convenience, let's pick up a very simple understanding. Consciousness is to be alive and aware, period. Consciousness is to be alive and aware. Obviously, awareness precedes aliveness. Because if you're not alive, you can't be. So extremely alive and extremely aware. Okay? So if you're not alive, the idea is to therefore get into closer, deeper understanding. So if you're not alive, the normal logical, you know, kind of variations of alive is if you're not alive, then you are dead. Then what you're dead, what you're dead means you are not in a position to be able to perceive and experience a whole lot of things. That obviously means that. Which means if you're not alive, many parts of your perception capabilities are kind of shut down or closed or masked or blinded. Okay. Therefore, aliveness from this terminology of consciousness means none of the defenses, shields, coverings, limitations that blind you exist, and they are all removed, and therefore there is pure observing. Okay.
Okay.
So such a beautiful thing. So pure observing. Pure observing of what? Pure observing of what? The fact that pure observing is taking place, that means there is an, into inverted commas, a process, an activity taking place. And what is activity or a process? Display of aliveness is equal to activity. You know, we are really working with language and playing with words as we take every cautious step. Do you realize that? What is aliveness? It's a display of, okay, life existing through an activity, okay? And if that activity has no normal nomenclature, saying that I'm eating, I'm talking, I'm sleeping, okay, I'm playing, I'm doing, you know, e-learning. Suppose you take away all of that activity which we have known, but if you are still active, then what is the terminology that we'll use? You are simply alive. And because you're simply alive, okay, and not doing anything, you're simply alive to the truth of your liveliness. Not a percentage, iota of a percentage of your energy of being alive is going into anything else, correct? That's pure aliveness with all the potential vibrancy, and that is pure consciousness. The simultaneous state of being alive and being conscious about everything potentially at that point of time, or being available for, you know, that intensity of knowing, that is pure consciousness. So in that, you know, that phenomenal, you know, kind of availability, the possibility of looking at things as they are, and so many things as they are, all right, without any restriction, that possibility becomes very, very high. And therefore, that level of consciousness, it's such a beautiful terminology. Therefore, deep consciousness of yourself or by yourself, okay, or in yourself. Look at the interesting thing. Of yourself, by yourself, in yourself. none of them matter. You know why? Because you're not different from that entity which is doing that, you know, conscious observation. Because only when there's a distance, there's a that and here is a I. There's a question of, you know, that one did it. Okay? There's a separation. But this is the source and this is the experiencer and this is the experienced. Such a beautiful thing. So there is nothing different from this. When there is nothing different from this, it is called the self. This water bottle is different from me. Subhashini is different from me. The laptop is different from me. I am not different from myself. So this ability to be observing something which is not different from my, from this observer is the self. And the process by which this deep, unfettered, unlimited, clean observation can take place is consciousness put together, that is the height of self-consciousness. And for the sake of convenience, we'll use the terminology self-awareness. So take away, strip away all this, you know, kind of a role-related, objective-related, you know, kind of evaluations and trips. Subhashini, and get into what I call as this pure observing. And like I said, language uses multiple options. So sometimes I think we need to use language only to take away, you know, the unimportant and unnecessary things to come to the purer one.
Yes.
Leads for the pure awareness observation process, which is the beautiful self-awareness that people have.
Wonderful, sir. Thank you. Thank you for that.
Well, okay. This actually reminds me of another question which I wanted to actually ask you. But we have different types of leadership, and we talk about different traits within the leadership, right? What do we mean by a self-aware leader? How does he look like, or how does he seem to be? What is the difference between regular leaders and a self-aware leader? How is it important for an organization from the business context? How do we basically know that an individual is a leader, but he is more of a self-aware leader? Because you take some example and elaborate on this point, it will make it much easier for us to understand.
Okay. So I'll pick up this question and look at its probably two parts. One is the example part that you talked about. But I think the more important part of this question is, how would you identify, how would you recognize, let's say, a self-aware leader? That's a good question. Because I think it's an evolutionary process, okay? So as one, you know, becomes more and more deeply reflective, as one becomes more and more undefensively, you know, kind of examining, looking at oneself, more than examining, looking at oneself. As one becomes more and more comfortable with deep observation and, you know, kind of recognition. Beautiful. These terminologies are also fantastic. Recognition. I have normal cognition, which is all role-bound. Recognition is the re-looking at myself. And therefore, it's a recognizing process. It's a very beautiful terminology. So when that happens, I think the most important thing that happens to you is that you are not defined by either your strengths or you are not limited by the so-called limitation. I think that's a beautiful thing that happens. You realize that both of them are such contextual, time-bound, space-bound, situation-bound realities. That's it. And then there's a liberation that takes place within. Because you know that you're not limited by that. Yeah, I was angry. Yeah, I was angry in that situation, in that particular kind of a context. Now I realize how silly I was. And for you to be able to look at yourself and say, you know, you have been such a, to use a bad language, you have been such an asshole in that situation, and you have a pretty comfortable, you're able to smile at yourself and say, oh God. Now the moment you're able to realize that, you may even pick up the phone and call up that person and say, you know what? I want to tell you, I really made a mess of it. I'm sorry. Because your differences just go away. Because you're able to make that very, very non-judgmental evaluation, first of all, about yourself. And the moment your evaluation and judgment goes, remember what we talked about. But the moment your evaluation compulsion goes, because any evaluation is subject to condition based on criteria. I'm using some words so quickly, you may miss it. I'm repeating that again. Every evaluation is based on some conditions, some criteria, some standards. Correct?
Right.
So now do you realize the power of the word unconditional love of a mother?
Absolutely.
That's it. Period. Because there is no precondition by which the mother is judging or evaluating the child. Right and wrong do not come into play. I think this beautiful quality of unconditionally accepting another human being happens, which is what Robin Williams was talking about. Where is a question of criteria? It's just about sharing your ability to be caring, period. That's it. So he talks about that. So the moment, and how can sharing, there is only one sharing in life. And that sharing is, you are opening up your consciousness space, which is so immense. And there is a place for everybody. 1.3 billion of this universe can be there. I can accommodate. But in my role of being the husband, I can accommodate one person, my wife, period. Do you recognize the serious limitations of our life with roles? All right. So this beautiful thing happens, Venkat. All right. So what are the, so the immensity of space, the immensity of spiritual space opens up. Now the immensity of the spiritual space, of the spiritual is the human spirit. Again, what he's talking about, the human spirit. The moment the human spirit, in beautiful Urdu Hindustani, insaniyat, wow, what a word, insaniyat. In Tamil, manidam. Oof, languages, poetic languages talk about it, insaniyat. Oof, I don't think I've heard a more equivalent, beautiful, romantic, appealing word about humanity than insaniyat. It's all about insaniyat, just being human. There's no, you know, kind of the limited compulsions and the competition of the doing. It's being, being human. So the moment that, because it's immense, it accommodates. Because it's immense, because of its sheer vastness, it brings your perspectives, it brings your outlook, it brings your mental, emotional, intellectual deployment to a much, much greater, more valuable intensity quality. So what happens in the first place? Your sensitivity as a human being becomes phenomenal. So the first quality of higher self-awareness, and it's such a beautiful thing, that this phenomenal human sensitivity that happens. Now in human sensitivity, I think the most simple way of describing that is the ability to see me in you. Whatever I grant to myself as a human being, I'm granting to you. From an emotional dimension. So that's sensitivity. Would I not be caring for myself? Is there any human being in the world who is saying that, no, I don't care about myself. I want to die the next minute. No, all of us. About future, about family, about my growth, about my achievement. It's all about me, me, me. We care so much, right? I think in sensitivity, what happens is beyond all this, you care to the other human being as you care for yourself. That's a foundation. And sensitivity is not just about human beings. You become more sensitive. You recognize that beautiful plant is also an amazing partner of nature. The water flowing is part of nature. Animals are part of nature. So there is a basic sensitivity about this whole drama of creation. And you become such an engaging player in that. So sensitivity becomes so much better. So that's the first part of it. Then something else happens. Because once you're sensitive and in the world of aliveness, you got to be acting, right? Now you have immensity and you have sensitivity and you got to be acting, because it's through action that you are seen to be alive. You become so much proactive rather than reactive.
Wow. Okay.
Because of proactivity, the masala, the material is in you. Whereas reactivity is when something happens to you and then you respond. Like Stephen Covey talks in, principle-centered leadership and 7 habits of highly effective people. There's a difference between reactivity and response. Okay? Between the provocation, trigger, and the reaction, if you take a pause, he calls that as the response reflection, which is very beautiful. So for when you're, when you're in touch with your immensity and you are extremely sensitive, you suddenly become so much empowered to be proactive. So sensitivity is one quality that comes up phenomenally that leads to you being more proactive. Okay? Typically. Now, look at these two combinations. So, which means you don't need invitations, you don't need licenses, you don't need provocations, you don't need appointments. You own up. You have that sense of you're in a space, you're in a place, you're in a context, and you are owning up that context. I am the situation, like they say, no? Either you're part of the problem or you're part of the solution. That's a beautiful quote many people talk about. I'm saying, yeah, you're either part of the problem or you're part of the solution, provided you are the situation. And that's the beauty. Tat tvam asi. I am the alive situation right now. That leads to one more quality, which is surplus mentality. Look at how nicely each one of these things, yeah. So you recognize the immensity of your consciousness. You see yourself in others. Therefore, sensitivity builds up. And along with the sensitivity, the ability to act, proactivity builds up. And proactivity and sensitivity are phenomenal things, which makes you actually a surplus mentality person. And, I keep quoting, and please give me the license to quote, because it's in Tamil, but I'll translate. Just a few days back, I'd been to a very senior, government official's office. Mm-hmm. I went to the office of the Director General of Police, Tamil Nadu. Mm-hmm. And I had a beautiful surprise for me there. Mm-hmm. I had a very graceful, nice meeting with him. It was about a socio-political context. But, I wanted the audience with him. So in that waiting room, which is a very beautiful room, as I entered, to my surprise, I saw in front of me one of my biggest idols in my life, Mahakavi Subramanya Bharatiya's photo. Ah, okay. Subramanya Bharatiya, one of the greatest poets. And below that photograph, Venkat and Subashini, was this beautiful caption, quote from him. And again, my heart melted. And that quotation was in Tamil, Niye Kadavul Endru Unar. Recognize that you are the God yourself. You know what it really means? It's very simple. It's connected to what we are talking right now. You are the ultimate creator of your own destiny. You have everything within you, which means you are a surplus entity. So this is the third quality that comes. Immense surplus mentality. Why? Because God is all pervasive. He's all competent. He is eternal, eternity, all pervasiveness, and fulfillment. That is a quality of the God element in the Indian philosophy. Therefore, it is called as the Sat, Chit, and Ananda. Fulfillment is Ananda. Sat is the eternal reality or the truth. Chit is all pervasive because that is a universal consciousness and energy which is flowing all around. So what happens to the individual human being is, in touch with this amazing immensity, he becomes a very surplus-minded person. So sensitivity, proactivity, surplus-mindedness. So you're so resourceful. So Bharatiya, this great guy said, it does not matter, what you do in life, what role you have in life. So he said, Vallavar Vayagam Kapavarenu. You could be the savior of the world. Or you could be a small trader carrying a basket of plantains and selling it on the street. It doesn't matter. பொய்யகல தொழில் செய்து வித் இன்டெகிரிட்டி வென் யூ ஆபரேட் பிறர் போற்ற வாழ்வோர் அண்ட் தி வேர்ல்ட் வில் அட்மயர் யூ வென் யூ ஆர் வித் இன்டெகிரிட்டி எங்கனமும் மேலோர் யூ ஆர் an awesome great person any which way. So the surplus mentality does not get determined by whether you are a small role in life or a big role in life, whether you are the grade 12 kind of an employee or whether you are the founder MD of the company, you are immensity, surplus mentality. And the most important thing, as a result of all this, you become extremely principle centered in life. Now, this principle-centeredness, as much as Stephen Covey would talk about that, I would say sometimes language, again, has its challenges. I would use the Eastern philosophy, both in Buddhism and Hinduism. In Buddhism, it is the Dhamma, okay? Buddham charanam gacchami, Sangham dharanam gacchami, Dhammam charanam gacchami. And in Hinduism, in India, Bharatiya culture, it's called Dharma. That balancing factor which holds the whole universe together, life together, meaningful existence together, that principle is called Dharma. And the foundation of Dharma, very beautifully, is again based on treating everybody else with the same kind of values, beliefs, as you would treat yourself, seeing yourself in the others, and being therefore righteous fairness into the individual. So these four characteristics, Venkat and Subhashini, stand out in a self-aware leader. Number one, sensitivity. Therefore, yes, he, for example, that's the reason why this goes just beyond what you may call as performance demanding roles or sharply performance demanding roles. For example, a corporate leader, he's supposed to produce business results, no question at all, at whatever level, from a supervisor till the chairman of the organization. But along with that, what you may call as a result-producing capability, if he is this conscious, self-aware person, then imagine how beautifully he will have the simultaneity of chasing the objective reality, the numbers, the targets, and yet building a culture which is very humane, which is very considerate, where people can enjoy, okay, a community of togetherness. And that team building is very qualitative. And if you ask me, I'm saying I've seen leaders of that kind. Far and few, in different levels, but there are leaders of that kind. I've seen this kind of leaders in bright young people at middle management level who I saw with self-awareness building up, shooting up like a meteor and going up to the corporate ladder, overtaking people four or five levels above them in a matter of few years. I've seen it happen at close quarters. I've seen this quality, you know, of all people in where? In union leadership. I will never forget this incident of this union leadership, experience of this self-awareness in Hyderabad. Principle-centeredness we are talking about, right? And here was this union leader, we were into a negotiation table, and you know how these negotiations can happen with union leaders. And this was a typical, he was a communist leader. And by the way, I have a lot of respect for many of these communist leaders, extremely principle-centered. I can remember from Comrade Dume in Andheri, Bombay, to K.M. Sundaram, to V.P. Chintan, to Narayan Rao, I'm talking about in Hyderabad. And as the negotiations were happening, the General Secretary of the Union, who was an employee, he kind of crossed the line. And he uttered something which was very insulting to the management. And as it hit the dialogue, the negotiation, as we kind of got a jerk with that and said, what nonsense is happening? To our utter surprise, this leader, he got up. He got up and he looked at us and said, I apologize first. No preliminary statements to anybody. No telling his team of people that, look, hold on, I'm going to talk. Nothing. He just got up and said, first, let me apologize. And he said, this is not on, this is not becoming of a team that I choose to represent. Okay. Then he turns at his team to that general secretary and says, you have no business to do what you did just now. If I'm chosen as your leader, as your president, I would have expected you to even at least consult me before you could have uttered what you uttered. which you have not done. And by doing that, you have brought disrepute and doubt to my credibility. And that is not acceptable. I walk out of this situation just right now if you do not apologize to the management. And he stood up and he apologized. And after he did that, he said, that's fine. Don't repeat that again. Then he said, sorry, sir. Is it okay if we can continue? Principle-centeredness. All right. I've seen it. So if you ask me, have you seen it in people? I've seen it in people. You've seen it in people with whom you have worked, interacted. I would easily talk about half a dozen people. Since they are names and they are specific, you know, maybe this forum doesn't give us that complete opportunity. I have also felt and experienced that in people who are distant. Nelson Mandela. Wow. Mahatma Gandhi. Of course, universally known, but in Nelson Mandela. You know, a person who for decades sat in that 6x6 kind of a room with a small little, you know, kind of a hole to look at a bit of sunshine that can come. And with that intense limitation, physical limitation, limitation of exposure, limitation of experience, limitation of any goodness of life, imprisonment, when he comes out, he has the capacity to accommodate the whole world without any bitterness. What selfless mentality, my God. So those are the qualities, Venkat. Proactivity, sensitivity, principle-centeredness, and immense selfless mentality. Therefore, self-aware leaders display these qualities a lot. And the combination of these four factors, and this is where I'm working, and you know, maybe hopefully someday it'll become a book, hopefully in the near future, where the qualities of the self-aware leader, and it can manifest into many combinations. Probably when we get into, you know, kind of dissecting and putting that together, we'll talk about all those, you know, types. And so the moment we talk about types, again, it goes into this evaluation modes and all that, but we'll not get caught up with that. Very nicely to be able to see patterns of self-aware leadership in action. Yeah.
Amazing. I was actually looking at the comments if we have any questions.
Okay.
But I don't think we have specific questions from the audience.
Okay.
Subashini, you have any specific points to be made? I think we have, as usual, we have passed the time. It was supposed to be for one hour for you both. But it's an amazing session. I think we can continue like this. But as Sir was actually mentioning about the monthly session, I would like to take this as an opportunity to request him to confirm one more date in the coming month where we might want to talk about the consciousness in detail, because I can still, you know, recollect the answer, the points that he had explained now, of course, your question on consciousness. I think it makes a lot of sense for us to have an elaborated session on it.
Yeah. You know, Venkat, it makes sense. You know, when I reflect on that, I realize that all of us, or most of us, constantly explore our life and our growth from two questions. One is a set of how questions, and one is a set of what questions. And I think the world is extremely fascinated and riding on how questions. How to be a good cook, how to be a good student, how to be a good manager, how to be a good leader, how to be a good husband. How to be is the biggest trip of life to take on all the roads. How to be a good political leader, how to be a citizen. How is required in the world? Because how teaches the methodology of becoming. The what part is a clarifying kind of question. What is it about? Okay. The world has got a bit of impatience about the what. So if you dwell too much on the what, they say that's okay. Too much of intellectual, whatever. If they are decent, they'll say too much of intellectual discussion. But if you are impatient, they'll say too much of intellectual bullshit. Okay, let's cut it off. But how can we practice that? Okay. So this will all the time be there. Fortunately or unfortunately, I'm so much more of the what person than the how person. But I always recognize the importance of the how part. Okay. I think it'll be fair, as much as it'll be, like you said, time-wise kind of challenge. But if we are talking about self-awareness, and if we are in touch with, therefore, the reality of self-awareness, then I think we need to be selfless-minded enough to know that nothing is going to limit us from exploring these concepts deeply and as much as required. So I'm saying more sessions. So obviously, if that's what it calls for, so I think the ability to respond to the call of life is the foundation of self-awareness. Wow. So if the call of life, okay, is placing a demand on us to spend more time on that, why would we not do that? So we'll take it up. No question.
Fantastic. Fantastic. Thank you. Thank you. I think it's time. I would request you both to be online. But for the audience, thanks a lot for joining us in this session. And let me, also take this opportunity to announce that we are planning to, between myself and Subashini and, two of my other team members, Ajiba and Pavya, between four of us, we would probably come out with a couple of more sessions in the coming months, specifically dwelling and deep diving into this concept of transformational leadership as well as self-awareness and different pointers like consciousness. And we would like to actually have in-depth conversation with Kitty sir and learn a lot in those terms. And I'm sure it's going to be of great benefit from the learning aspect and also building our self-awareness. Thank you, friends. Thanks a lot for participating in this, and looking forward to more such sessions. Thank you.